Good afternoon. I'm Pam Marcucci, and I'd like to welcome you to the Jacobs Institute's 2019 College Summer Intern Presentation. So over the past 7 summers, the JI has hosted 26 college students in our 9-week internship program. Half of them have either attended or went on to attend the University of Buffalo, so clearly we have a strong relationship there. The program tasks interns with concrete projects ranging from developing a manual that explains the imaging modalities at the Gates Vascular Institute to working with Dr. Davies and UB's Center for Computational Research to create algorithms that can potentially predict stroke in certain patient populations. At the end of each program, the interns explain their projects in final presentations, such as this one. We like to say that once an intern at the Jacobs Institute, always a part of the Jacobs Institute. So watch out, you guys. This is because many of the interns' projects live on after they leave or are further developed. Jake's imaging manual is sent to every industry engineer and sales rep who participates in our clinical immersion programs. Noah's video about the internship is posted on our website. Jackie's slides provided us with quantitative data on the startlingly high rates of stroke and heart disease in Western New York. The work of this 2019 intern cohort forms a groundwork for a number of marketing and engineering projects that you're going to hear about today during their presentations. In addition, many of our interns have gone on to become JI employees. So far, we have hired 6 former interns for either part-time or full-time work because we saw them in action as interns and we liked what we saw. So we stay in touch with our past interns in a number of ways. In May of 2017, we sent out a survey to all of our former interns to see how they felt the internship had impacted their educational and career experiences. We received responses from 2/3 of them, and you can see some of the responses behind me. In June 2018, we had an intern reunion that brought back 18 former interns. This past March, Allison reached out to past interns so she could write a "Where Are They Now?" article for the JI newsletter. And here you can see where some of them are now. So from California with Apple to Medtronic to grad school, all over the place. So why do we continue to host the internship program summer after summer? Well, the JI summer internship program increases our productivity. The interns offer us more hands and new perspectives and fresh ideas. In fact, we are revisiting a method that Matt developed during his internship a few years ago to allow for puncture and suture closure for a new type of 3D printed model that we're developing. The program fosters leadership skills among our staff as they serve as mentors. Pretty much everyone at the JI is involved with the internship program in some way or another. The program also fosters collaboration with our partner organizations. We've had super cool joint intern projects with UB's School of Engineering and its Center for Computational Research. The Kaleida Health physicians and staff have helped enrich the interns' experience, giving lunch and learn presentations and offering them shadowing experiences in the clinical spaces. The program helps us spread the word about the JI. The interns are JI public relations ambassadors who publicize our activities throughout their schools and workplaces, creating openings for future collaboration. It's also an opportunity for the JI to give back to the community by providing students with the chance to enhance their skills and become better future employees wherever they work. Finally, the internship program is the opportunity to show students they don't have to go to Minneapolis or Boston or San Francisco to find cool jobs. We have cutting-edge jobs right here in Western New York. So thank you for taking the time to attend this year's presentation. Please do not hesitate to reach out if you'd like to be involved with our internship program or if you have new ideas for us to try. So now I'm going to turn it over to Allison Cooperman. She's going to say a few words about this year's program. Thank you.
Thanks, Pam, and welcome, everybody. I'm Allison Cooperman, the Communications and Community Outreach Manager for the Jacobs Institute. Each year, we are fortunate to find incredible talent. The internship program is a year-round labor of love for the Jacobs Institute. Within just a few weeks of this program, we'll be gearing up for 2020 recruitment, so if you know of any interested students, please send them our way. Last fall, Pam and I manned the JI booth at the UB STEM Career and Internship Fair. We showed our 3D models and regaled tales of past interns projects, and as well as where they are now. In the midst of this large arena, a sizable crowd of wide-eyed UB students surrounded us. We left the internship fair with very sore throats, but over 100 resumes. We recognized that there was a lot of interest on the part of students to be a part of the JI, but none of them had even had a chance to set foot in the offices yet. So we organized our first ever internship open house for UB students. Ultimately, we received 34 applications from 8 different universities for just 3 internship slots. Emma, Zach, and Gianna joined us for a summer that we call an internship unlike any other. How many interns can say that they've had lunch with luminaries from across the medical campus, troubleshot with biomedical engineers, and shadowed surgeons in an operating room, and touched cadaver hearts? Ours can. Their work helped the JI establish quantifiable ways to compare our 3D models to human anatomy. In order to best understand how new medical devices will perform inside of the body, we have to create the most realistic replicas in which to test them. This is an integral part of the success of our I2R, or Idea to Reality Center. It's meant to accelerate the innovation process by getting constant physician and engineering feedback in order to develop smart engineered devices and get them to patients faster to save lives. Each intern managed incredible projects, collaborated with JI staff, and made a tangible impact here. They are forever a part of the JI family. Without further delay, here are your 2019 summer interns.
Good evening, everyone. So the JI is breaking the boundaries of what is possible by using 3D printing for medical device innovation.
By creating the most lifelike replicas of human anatomy, JI engineers develop an ideal proving ground for prototypes dreamed up by inventors and brought to you by the I2R, or Idea to Reality Center.
So these same replicas are being sought after by large medical device companies to usher in the next generation of medical devices using JI's engineering services.
With this, the JI can help inventors and companies create or improve life-saving devices.
Our summer project centered on comparing JI's 3D models to human anatomy. I sought to understand the diseased heart vessels filled with calcified deposits to replicate these in JI's models.
I worked to measure the compliance of these 3D printed vessels in order to properly mimic the qualities of actual vessels in the body.
I helped the JI to convey in its future marketing materials how their models are highly comparable to human anatomy, while also bringing uniformity to the JI brand.
So ultimately, we help bridge understanding of vessels in the human body and JI's 3D printed vessels in one amazing summer.
So welcome to our summer internship presentation on atherosclerosis, aortas, and arteries. I'm Emma, and I'll be talking about atherosclerosis and 3D printed aorta imaging. So raise your hand if you or someone you know has had a heart attack. Keep your hands raised and raise your hand if you or someone you know has had high cholesterol or high blood pressure. So by age 60, 2 in every 3 people in the US will have cardiovascular disease. And today I'm going to talk about how some effects on the heart has on the aorta and how the Jacobs Institute is innovating technology to help. So what's an aorta? Your aorta is the largest artery in your body, and it comes directly out of your heart to deliver oxygen-rich blood to all of your cells. Atherosclerosis is a cardiovascular disease that is characterized by the buildup of plaque in your arteries. Plaque is made up of fat, cholesterol, and calcium, and when that builds up in your arteries, this can lead to high blood pressure and heart strain. If pieces of that plaque break off, it can lead to heart attack or stroke. When the plaque builds up in your arteries, your body launches an immune response. Your body tries to stabilize the plaque by cementing it down with calcium. This prevents the plaque from breaking off and causing that heart attack or stroke. So why do calcifications matter if it's your body's attempt to help? Well, in that attempt to help, the calcifications actually make your blood vessels a lot more rigid and they lose their stretchy quality. This makes it a lot harder for surgeons to navigate blood vessels with medical devices during endovascular surgery. So you can see in the video up here, there's one on the left that has a rigid plastic, and it's really hard to get the catheters through the rigid material versus getting it through the flexible rubber material on the right. At the Jacobs Institute, we can make a 3D printed model that looks and feels like vessels for surgeons to practice on and for medical device testing. The blue calcification spots that you see are the calcifications that we add. The JI is able to add these calcifications that are replicas that are directly from patient CT scans. This is good for surgeons to practice on because they're incredibly patient specific. This is also a great innovation for medical device testing, since animal testing won't be able to test animals with cardiovascular disease. This is because humans are actually the only creatures on Earth that have cardiovascular disease or plaque or calcifications in their blood vessels. This makes testing medical devices with the JI's models more clinically relevant than animal testing, since we're able to test these disease state models. The advantages to our 3D printed models are that they're less expensive than other testing methods, they're quick on a 3D printer, they have a realistic blood vessel feel, you can easily add any unique calcifications, and they simulate actual patient anatomy, which makes them extremely accurate. So you've heard it said that a picture is worth 1,000 words, but did you know that a video is actually calculated to be worth 1.8 million words? My project this summer was to compare JI 3D models that have calcifications with actual disease state human hearts to improve our 3D printed models and to show their superiority of these models in the use of vascular technologies. My specific goals were to create one of the JI's 3D printed aorta models and then take a video inside of the vessel. Then I would take a video of the inside of a cadaver vessel and develop a repeatable test method for capturing videos of cadaver vessels. So to make my own 3D printed model of a calcified aorta, first you start off with a CT or O-arm scan. From there, you go into a software called Mimics, which allows you to select which areas of the scan to make a 3D image of. At the JI, we select the blood pool on the inside of the aorta. After you have that 3D image, you go into Mesh Mixer, which actually makes the aorta vessel from the solid image in Mimics. Basically, this would be like taking the scan of a straw, and then in Mimics, just selecting the water pool on the inside of that straw. And then in Mesh Mixer, building a straw around that water pool. So after Mesh Mixer, the slicing software translates that 3D picture into a language that the 3D printer can read, which is called G-code. The 3D printer reads the G-code and then prints out the actual vessel. So while I was in the process of making my own model, I also got to observe some of the quality control testing that we do with our 3D printed models. While I was there, there were several models that would leak right where the large calcifications were. We would run water through the model, and when the pressure built up, it would spring a leak along the big calcifications. The process we were originally using in Mesh Mixer, the software that makes those hollow vessels, was this. We would take the blood pool and then offset to make the thickness of the aorta. Then we would add in the calcifications. And this would work, except there wouldn't be a uniform thickness all throughout the vessel. You can see that where the calcifications are, the walls are a lot thinner. And this is why they would split during our quality control testing. I thought about this problem and started thinking about how to fix the issue of leaking models. So I reordered some of the steps in Mesh Mixer to have a uniform vessel thickness all throughout the pool, even with large calcifications. So I first took the blood pool and then added in the calcifications after that. I then offset so that it would create a uniform vessel thickness everywhere, even where the large calcifications were. So hopefully in the future, this will prevent leaks in our system. So in order to take pictures on the inside of vessels, I needed something called an endoscope, which is this. And on this side, it has a camera that can record pictures and videos. And it also has lights so that you can take videos on the inside of dark vessels. So I'll try to show you guys. So this is the inside of this model. You can see the yellow palish parts are the calcifications. And they're made out of a material that's more rigid. And the pink walls are made out of a really stretchy material, which will actually mimic what an actual vessel will feel like. So you can see that it looks and it'll feel like an actual vessel. So these models are really cool, but to better understand our own models and to market our models to customers, we needed a real aorta. So the next couple slides will have pictures and videos of real human cadaver hearts. So if that makes you uncomfortable at all, feel free not to look. We are able to dissect two different cadaver hearts for our use in imaging. One of those had a small amount of calcification, and the other one had a lot of calcification. So next I'll show a video of the inside of the more calcified aorta. You can see the inside of the parts that are white are the calcifications, and the more orangish yellow parts are plaque that hasn't been calcified yet. And then in the back, you see those three holes, and those are actually the three vessels that branch off of the aorta on the aortic arch. And you can see the ones on the side have a bunch of the calcifications around them, which means it was super rigid when we were feeling them. And also, it would have been super hard to try to get any kind of medical device past that, which is why we need models that have those calcifications in it to mimic the disease state hearts. So after taking these videos and pictures, I wrote a step-by-step document for how I did what I did. This is for anyone in the future who needs to image the inside of cadaver vessels at the JI, so they knew exactly how I took my pictures and videos. Comparing the JI models side by side, you can see that they have patient-specific calcifications. The calcifications are both pale yellow, the vessels are a flexible pink, and they have distinctly noticeable calcifications. For future work after I'm gone, the JI will use these photos and videos to compare our 3D printed models with silicone and glass alternatives. Those comparison videos will then be compiled into a marketing video for the 3D printers company website. So as a reminder, these are the advantages to our 3D printed models. Specifically, I worked on improving and documenting calcifications to be used in the future to compare with JI's models to better mimic disease state. I did this by making a 3D printed JI model. I reordered JI's mesh mixer process to prevent leaks. I imaged the inside of the calcified JI models. I imaged the inside of the cadaver hearts. And I made a work instruction form for imaging cadaver hearts. So I specifically worked with calcifications, and next Zach is going to talk about the realistic blood vessel feel and how we took a qualitative feels like into quantitative numbers.
All right, thank you, Emma. Just want to thank everyone for coming out. Let's get into the engineering part. Well, the math, rather. So I will be discussing appliance and 3D modeling, going from feels to facts. So as Emma has just stated, currently JI's models are very realistic. They feel and behave very similar to actual vessels in the human body. So it was my goal to apply like engineering principles and mathematical relationships to ultimately better quantify this feel and bring it from the qualitative to a quantitative realm. So more specifically, I was tasked with building a system capable of measuring the compliance to compare human anatomy to 3D printed anatomy. So the first question asked is, what is vessel compliance? So the most intuitive way to understand vessel compliance is to understand that of stretchiness. So a balloon is an example of something that has high compliance. A small amount of force can result in a high stretch or a lot of compliance. A counterexample or something with low compliance is this table. So that same amount of force can be applied to the table, but it will not result in very much compliance or stretch. So the next question we logically ask is, do JI's 3D printed vessels expand with pressure? Well, we've already established they do, given that they behave very similar to actual vessels in the human body. But the question is, to quantify it, how much do these JI 3D printed vessels actually expand? So to do that, we'll need a mathematical relationship. So this is the equation that we use for compliance. This was found by David Tobey and other researchers at Harbor UCL Medical Center down in California. So what they did, they actually measured the compliance of actual aortas in the human body or in vivo. So now it is this is what we use as a benchmark to compare data that we find through benchtop testing or in vitro in the lab by using this equation. So to further break it down, we need to find change in diameter. So this is the device we use. It's called the Kianz micrometer. It's a kind of cool system that basically uses a laser and detects very accurately the diameter of the specimen of interest, in this case, a segment of an aorta that we printed out at JI. And then it outputs to a screen in millimeters. Pretty simple there. So now, remembering the same equation, we need to remember that we need also the change in pressure. This is the device we use. So the first circle, that's outlining the pressure transducer or the sensor, which actually senses the pressure of the vessel. And then here's the signal conditioner. This essentially just amplifies the signal so that we can actually do something with the data once we get it the setup going. But the one thing that is different with this device than the last device is this device actually requires calibration. And calibration is essentially going from a unit that the device speaks in, or voltages, and converting it to what we can understand in clinical or human terms for pressure or millimeters of mercury. And this is a process. It's quite simple. So we have a pressure gauge here as our known standard of what pressure should be. We connect it through a three-way valve. We attach a pressure transducer, and then we attach a pressure source. So now what we did, we recorded the pressure and the corresponding voltage from 20 to 200 millimeters of mercury, just to account for the full typical physiological range of 120 over 80. And we recorded at each point, and that gives us a nice clean correlation. So all you need to take away from this chart is the fact that now we can retrieve the data and voltages from the device and use these equations to output them in millimeters of mercury or pressure. Okay, so now that the engineering is out of the way, here is the completed setup. So we first begin with a fluid source. So this allows us to, or this provides the fluid. So the biggest thing to note is that it has to be 16 inches elevated, which is essential to mimic diastolic pressure of a resting heart. Next, we have a heater to heat up the water to 37 degrees Celsius or body temperature. Continuing on, we have a pump, which is a fancy pulsatile flow pump, it's called, which very accurately mimics the beating of a human heart. From there, we have just simply the half-inch PVC tubing that allowed us to connect all of the components together. Five is what we call colloquially as a degasser. It just essentially removes air from the system as the pump is pushing fluid throughout. And so now I'm going to pass out some of the vessels just so you guys get an idea of how they feel and some of the connections. So this is a sixth component. This is just a barb fitting, which allows us to attach the PVC tubing. And then we redesigned them so that we can attach this lure fitting to attach the pressure transducer. Finally, number eight, we have the actual segment of an aorta of interest. And then outlining number nine is a Keyence micrometer. Okay, so this is the actual setup from the lab. So in a different order, but going from left to right, this is the pulsatile flow pump here. We have the elevated water basin with the heater attached. All of this connects to the vessel of interest, which has the Keyence on either side measuring the diameter. We have the pressure transducers, and then not included in the left side are all the electronic components. So here we have the, this is the monitor, obviously measuring the diameter output from the Keyence micrometer. We have the signal conditioner, which is amplifying the pressure signal. And then arguably most important, this is the oscilloscope. So this is where we can see the data in real time, but more importantly, export it to Excel to analyze and draw conclusions. And this is the setup in action. So you can see how the pump actually mimics the human heart, and you can see PVC tubing actually bouncing. That's because it has 60 beats per minute. The water is obviously being heated up by this guy. One thing to note that is important, I'd say, is you can see the monitor is oscillating from about 28 to 30, just to give you an idea that this is truly pulsating like an actual aorta would do in the human body. And then, of course, you can see the waveforms. So next, we have a nice, clean close-up of it, the most compliant vessel in action. So the green is from the laser, from the Keyence micrometer, measuring the diameter in real time. The biggest takeaway from the video is the fact that when it is expanded, that is analogous to systole, when the heart is beating, and then when it relaxes or contracts back downward, that is analogous to diastole, when the heart is at rest and filling. And then, so this is how we have raw data before we processed it in units that the device understands. But now we have a post-processed data in terms we can understand and interpret as humans in millimeters of mercury and millimeters for diameter. So remembering this equation, so this is where it comes full circle, because we have to use the same equation so we can ensure that the we can match the data to clinical data so that we know if we're even on the right track at all. So we take the change in diameter, the change in pressure, and then the diameter at diastolic pressure to ultimately gather compliance data. Okay, so now you're all asking, why does it really matter for the JI? So ultimately, this setup will allow JI's engineers to experiment with different material blends, different vessel sizes and thicknesses to categorize the full range of vessels in the human body to make the most accurate models possible, which from a clinical perspective is important for doctors so that they can experiment with patient-specific models before they even go into the operating room so they can ensure the high success rates. From an industrial standpoint, it allows medical device companies to come in and test their devices to ensure that their FDA approval is actually warranted, but more importantly, to ensure that the devices do not cause harm to the patients and work as efficiently as possible. From an educational standpoint, they're very visually appealing and accurate, so it allows young minds entering into the medical field to really get a grasp of some of these abstract concepts. And finally, the sum of what we did over the summer allows us to put JI in a position to spread the word of what is possible at the JI to ultimately improve the health of Western New York. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Gianna D'Amico, and for the third and final part of our presentation, I'm going to be talking about design and marketing. So first, I'm just going to do a short little activity. I'm going to show you three slides, one with a photo, a second with a sound, and a third with a phrase. And if you guys can all say what word comes to your mind first when you see it or hear it, that'd be great. So first, the photo.
Target.
And the sound.
Microsoft.
Yeah, Microsoft, Windows, all the above.
Disney World.
Yep. Awesome. So this is branding. You can see a picture, a simple color or shape or combinations of colors or shapes, sounds at certain frequencies or even phrases, and you're able to identify where they came from, if they came from a specific company or brand. Isn't it funny that a fruit can be a phone company or that a gaming platform could be a letter of the alphabet? This is where I come in as a designer. I work with branding every day, whether it be using someone else's branding guidelines to make my deliverables at work, or in this case at the JI, creating my own. So my project one for this summer was creating a new coherent look and voice for the Jacobs Institute. So these are actually on the end of the aisles in, like they look like this basically. If you guys wanna flip through them and pass them around while I talk about this, because I can only talk about it for so long, because it's a little boring. But so we have three parts. There's diction, organizational values, and a style guide. So for part one, diction, we talk about the company name, the writing style, basic grammar guide, positioning statement, category descriptors, and brand name and usage guidelines. So this next slide is an example of a screenshot of one of the pages going into category descriptors and the way to use the Jacobs Institute's name in a certain type of document and subsequent uses as well. Part two talks about the organizational values for the Jacobs Institute, which goes into the goals of the Jacobs Institute, the emotional appeal that we're trying to elicit, and the use of photo video materials, which means when and where to use photo video materials and what type of photo video materials that we want to use. So, for example, we have a photo here that kind of goes along with the organizational value of community outreach and education. This was actually a tour of middle schoolers in the Buffalo area. The second photo is more of the clinical side and the more engineering side. So we have implementation of a C-arm and an actual 3D printed model, as well as proper use of lead and gloves while doing a simulation. So part three is the style guide. I go into the color palette, which you see here. This is the primary color palette and the secondary color palette. The secondary color palette is more for pops of color or emphasis when needed. And I tried to use names that associated themselves with the Jacobs Institute, like Aquamentis, Innovation Red, or Neuro Lavender. And this is the color palette for the I2R. So appropriate typefaces is something else touched upon in the style guide, which are even used in this presentation. logos, logo use, so both the Jacobs Institute and the I2R logo. This is a screenshot that's an example of the ratio of spacing allowed between how big the logo is and then the space around that before more text or photos can be. And templates. So there are links in the branding guidelines to templates for the employees at the Jacobs Institute for nameplates, badges, business cards, or anything like that, packaging. So far, I have been the only one to use the branding guidelines since they just were finished. So obviously the cover themselves comply. Name tabs for focus groups, the programs for the presentations, which you guys also have in your hands, and the flyer and Eventbrite invitations for this presentation, which you guys have probably already seen already as well. So these are subject to review and approval by the Jacobs Institute and will soon be used in the everyday life of an employee. So the takeaway of doing something like this, for the JI, it's kind of obvious. I'm creating a coherent look and feel for the voice of the JI. Myself, I am gaining an added level of branding as a graphic designer, which is very important. It's one thing to be able to use brand in a working environment, but to be able to create your own branding guidelines kind of adds another extra level of understanding. So my second project, the goal was to document the unique capabilities of the JI's 3D printed vascular flow models. So this is kind of general. So there was a few ways that I went about this. One, creating infographics. Two, photo video work. And three, use of Sketchfab. So infographics, you guys can see them up here and here and all on the desks. I have them all passed out. So the purpose of doing something like this is to communicate statistics or facts in a clear, coherent, organized fashion. And they're very eye-catching and kind of like hook you in to learn more information. And the use of these would be displayed events such as this, a use for social media, and the infographics that I created specifically were for awareness of cardiovascular disease. And so here they are, blown up. The colors are a little bit off. The actual colors are on the ones on the desk. It's just the lighting in here. And Sketchfab. I had no idea what Sketchfab was when I came to the Jacobs Institute, so I'm gonna explain it to you. It's an internet platform to share, sell, or purchase 3D printed or virtual reality files. The Jacobs Institute is just using the 3D right now, and so they can be viewed on mobile, desktop, or virtual reality browsers, and the JI uses them to send URLs to future customers to show what their models are like. And so the best way to do this is just kind of to show you what this is like. So if you guys have smartphones, you want to take them out and take a photo of this QR code, and there's also QR codes around on the tables if this doesn't work for you. With like a URL if you want to look at it later. But as you see in these videos, the ones on the left are the STL files before you put them into Sketchfab, and this is what Emma and Zach worked out in MeshMixer for me. And then I took that and was able to make what is on the other side, the glossy red, more lifelike look. And there's also annotations on there that, so as like someone who is a customer of the JI, you can turn it around on your phone or zoom in or zoom out and actually see the different properties that the models have to offer. So if you guys can't get it on your phone now and want to look later, there are those things on the desk that have a URL and a code. So, photo video work. This was probably the thing that took the longest for me and most of my time at the Jacobs Institute. So this consisted of day-to-day documentation of employees, engineers, testing, capturing events like tours, educational opportunities, high school internships and simulations, and then documenting our internship as well. And I will actually show you a marketing video that I created for our internship at the end of this presentation. And it also has just some fillers of the documentation of day-to-day JI employees. So the purpose of doing something like this is a need for fresh photo video content. A place like the JI as a startup is very, it's a place for innovation. So it's always has new things up and coming, so we have to keep refreshing materials like this, and obviously, as I said before, is my goal to document the unique capabilities of the JI models. So I'm just going to flip through a few of my favorite photos that I took and edited as I was here. We want to photograph the modern look of the JI to kind of emphasize that cutting edge and the internship and learning opportunities. As you can see, these ones, simulations, work with physicians, more of the technical side. This one I'm actually going to talk about for a second. So this one really outlines one of the organizational values for the Jacobs Institute, which is collaboration. As you guys saw when you came into this building, the Jacobs Institute is on the fifth floor. So the first through fourth floors are operating rooms, and all the floors above us are research. So kind of that collaboration being sandwiched between physicians and researchers. And in this case, we have a physician and medical device companies working together in this crossing of the arms intersecting at a 3D printed model of the JI, which kind of represents that where do all of these different disciplines come together? Engineering, physicians, medical device companies, all at the JI, which is that crossing of the arms, which I think is a really cool way to show what the Jacobs Institute is all about. And this is a model before and after a graft was put in. So, thus far, what have we done with photo video? I've created folders full of raw and edited photos. So this is for communication of ideas in a more visual and exciting way. Communication with medical devices or medical device companies and customers, website and Sketchfab use. In Sketchfab, actually, we can put in photos and videos into those annotations, which is actually the next step on what we're going to be doing. To be used for marketing videos and comparing the JI's models to other types of models, just like Emma did in her presentation. So the takeaway from the second goal for the JI was creation and the start of this vault for photos that all of the employees can dip into when needed. A new look for Sketchfab. As I showed you guys on the screen, that glossy red vessel-y look is a lot more different than the first one that they made before I came here. It was more like Zach's models that he passed around, kind of opaque. And this look is a lot more appealing to customers and eye-catching. Infographics, the revamping of outdated and brand non-compliant files is very important. And for myself, I personally had never really worked with photo video before this. I was just mostly a graphic designer. And so this was gaining a lot of practical in-field experience, which is very important for me as a designer and my portfolio. So, concluding video. As I said earlier, I put together a little 3-minute video to be put on the website for the JI that kind of goes along a day in the JI and the day in the internship that we had. Yeah, as you can see, I'm not in any of the video, so it was weird to be on camera. So, the bigger picture, I would just like to conclude with how all three of our projects kind of connected. So Emma's project was the physical part of everything, the 3D printing, and Zach was able to put this in a technical way with numbers and quantifying her conclusions. And so I was kind of the bridge between the two. I was able to put the conclusions that they came up with into photo, video, and all different other visual materials. So together, I would say that we successfully were able to complete our goal of documenting the unique capabilities of JI's 3D printed vascular models. Thank you, guys. So if anyone has questions, this would be the time.
Dr. Hopkins?
This was great. Really enjoyed it. What's your sense of the level of awareness within this community locally and nationally and internationally as to the recognition of the JI and what it does, and how would you take what you've done and use that to increase the level of awareness for this institute?
So I think what I was doing, which is more of the marketing side and putting their stuff like in a visual sense, would be a really good way to kind of bring that awareness through new materials and things like that to show people what is going on here. And before I came here, I don't know if I could speak for you guys, but I really wasn't aware of not being in a medical field. I wasn't really sure about what was going on at the Jacobs Institute, and I had to do a lot of research and looking into it and things like that. So I do think that the marketing effort that we made this summer is very important because more people should be knowledgeable on what's going on here. Really cool things.
And I go to school in Pennsylvania at Messiah College, and people that are biomedical engineers are always looking for different internships. And so I'm definitely going to go back and tell them that this was an amazing experience that they should apply.
Personally, I'll spread the word as well. But ultimately, I think like true exposure comes down to marketing for sure.
Yeah, our sense is that the JI really is still kind of a light under a bushel basket that most people don't really know about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, we're hoping we change that just a little bit.
Hopefully.
Anything else?
Oh. Oh, yeah.
After working at the Jacobs Institute in the medical field, has that influenced your career path at all, or the way you think that you might be going after college?
I'll start. For me, I mean, I've always been fascinated by like the human body, like we're an amazing thing. So yeah, I mean, for me, it just solidified that I like the medical field. But I mean, it's so broad that it's hard to say. Like, I think it's all fascinating.
Me personally, I've been back and forth between being or wanting to be a medical illustrator or graphic designer and things like that. So I've tried different jobs or internships in both. And this was the first one that I did more of that medical side. And if anything, that's been like, oh, I really got to do something like this in the future. It's so cool to be able to do what I love, but apply it to something really cool like the medical field, which is something that I'm interested in, but it's not really my specialty. So the Jacobs Institute has really opened my eyes to possibilities like that that I didn't really know were possible.
Yeah, this internship kind of solidified. I knew that I wanted to work at like either a nonprofit or a startup company with biomedical engineering. Working here really solidified that. Yeah.
Jana, I love that you put your takeaways in your presentation. So I'm just curious, Zach and Emma, what's your biggest takeaway from the program?
For me, I'd say it's definitely technical communication. So like breaking down some of these concepts and like really teasing out like how well you truly understand it was a big takeaway. And like sort of always just keeping the bigger picture in mind.
Yeah, I worked a lot with a program called Mesh Mixer, and I work a lot with that during my research team at school that makes prosthetics and orthotics, and I learned a lot of things here about the program that I'm definitely going to take back to help improve my team there.
There's Allison.
We have some over here too.
Yeah, Joe. Oh my gosh, Jill. There's Jill and then
Hoffman.
Yeah.
Can you comment on, I guess, because it's more for the engineers, how do you think what you learned at school translates into what you did for the internship? Things maybe you didn't learn in school, some of those skills, versus things that, like Emma said, you didn't know measurements. Or, so how did that kind of factor into your project? Do you think that you wish you would have learned some of these skills maybe in undergrad, or?
I think a lot of undergrad engineering is more training you to learn how to think, and I think internships like this just like progress that even further.
So for me, I would say like the biggest thing I learned that I didn't learn in undergrad would be just like business logistics, is like actually getting things done. Like, yeah, you can think of an idea or you can have like a concept in mind, but like you have to go through the hierarchy and kind of get an NDA and like all these terms I didn't even realize. So it sort of like puts it in perspective, like, okay, like things are theoretically possible, but like in business it's a whole different ballgame.
Okay, so my question is a little bit similar to what the previous questioner asked. And the big thing I think for you, or that I noticed is in your video, you're not just in the lab all the time and doing stuff. Right. You actually were meeting with a lot of people and doing a lot of interacting. And the impression I have from the JI from past talks and things like that is one of the major things that the JI brings for you guys is this interaction across all kinds of boundaries that you're not just in the lab with JI. You're actually learning other types of skills that are going to actually, I would argue, maybe carry into your future in a different and more powerful way than just the lab stuff that you do. This is an impression. I'm just wondering if that similar to what you're experiencing or am I off base?
No, I think that's right on point. It's really networking based, so they really emphasize right off. Like right in the first week, they're like, this is the week you're learning and this is the week you're gonna just run around talking to people. And I think, you know, we're a social species, and I think nothing is unlike just getting other people's perspective, because perspective is everything.
I'm not an engineer, but I can kind of talk to that. So, I mean, you know, the one photo that I talked about with that collaboration aspect in the JI, that's kind of what you were talking about, of how like there is always different types of people going in and out, and that is something that I've never like dealt with before. It's usually just me on a computer, which is like similar to them in a lab. And so that was really cool to experience that.
Yeah, I would say a lot of people think engineers are like bad at talking to other people, or that it's just like, oh, you're just good at math. But it's so much more than that, and you see that here at this internship. Like, we got to dissect human hearts, which was amazing. We got to work with other engineers, and it was amazing, yeah.
Got it. Like that.
So just to follow up, do you think that the word collisions is the right word to describe what goes on at the JI?
Yeah. Yes.
I think that nails it.
Good one.
We'll go with that one. But to touch on that, actually, that was my initial motivation to actually really try my hardest to get this position, because it's just truly amazing to see like how they take the perspective of, okay, well, these engineers are over here doing research, and then businessmen are running around, you know, accounting, or, you know, right? So it's like someone that has a perspective to say, let's bring it all in one building. I think it's truly visionary.
So for each of you, what was the biggest problem or challenge that you faced, and how did you overcome it or solve it?
All right, let's start on this end.
A lot of what I did, I didn't know how to do before I came here. Like, I didn't know how to make a model or take images of different things like that. So a lot of it was I think the hardest part was trying to talk to all the different people to get those parts moving so that I knew what I needed to do almost. And sometimes if someone was like away on vacation or not here, I was able to kind of shadow different things. Like that's how I even started doing the mesh mixer optimization thing with all those icons up there. I wouldn't have done that if everything was like going directly in order, but because there was things don't always go the way you plan, so you find other things to do and other ways to help around the JI.
For me, it was definitely the hardest in the first week because I am not in a pre-med field, and so a lot of the anatomical terms and things like that I had not been exposed to before. And so it was definitely getting accommodated to the more of the vascular surgery aspect of it, because being able to understand that is very key in being able to display it in a visual way. And it was really great to have this experience at the JI because I'm a very hands-on learner and visual learner. So being able to go in the cath labs and to be able to go into the OR and help Emma with her heart dissection and practice on the Mentis, which is basically like this endovascular surgery simulator where you actually get to put in the catheters yourself and try that kind of stuff. That was all very valuable to me because I was able to pick it up much quicker than I would have done out of textbook. So that was probably the biggest like hump in my journey, but after kind of getting a little bit of that down, it was a lot of fun.
So for me, I'd say it definitely happened in the first week as well. And it was like, what even is the problem? So it's like with all engineering, it's like you have to ask the right assumptions or the right questions and then tease out the assumptions. So I would say just really breaking it down to see like what the problem is. So like it's kind of like general, like any engineering problem, but that's my answer.
Anything else?
Well, if there's no more questions, let's give our 2019 interns a hearty round of applause. And then we invite you across the way for our reception, and you can come talk to them more about their projects and see the Jacobs Institute. Thank you so much for spending your afternoon with us, everybody.
Thanks,
everyone.
Thank you.